tonight on Arena. Paul Muldoon on the upcoming Irish tour of Muldoon's Picnic, and Eleanor Methven on playing one of the great Shakespearean roles, Prospero. Five one double 51 is the text. You can tweet the programme at RTE Arena. Poet Paul Muldoon is on the road again with Muldoon's Picnic, visiting Limerick, Letterkenny, Belfast and Dublin from the 10th through until the 14th of August. The Picnic is a live touring variety show of his own invention, a mix of house band, Rogue Oliphant, Paul as host and a changing lineup of writers and musicians along the way. Paul Muldoon, will be speaking to him shortly from New York. But first of all, let's hear him in action with Rogue Oliphant.
Some sigh for those nine bean rows. Some the heavenly abode. Some sigh for the binary. Some the binary code. Some load a hermaphrodite brig with a cargo of tin. Some ride with Quanah Parker. Some ride against the wind. And those of us who've ridden the white horse in our own expeditionary force, now weep that history must run its course. Now weep that history must run its course.
Little section there from The Riders by Rogue Oliphant. The voice of Paul Muldoon there with the band, which also features Cort O'Riordan as bass player. The Riders is the name of the track. It comes from the LP Highlights of the Low Life. All very poetic, it has to be said, Paul Muldoon, in terms of that beautiful antithesis of highlights and low life. Is this another way of exercising your poet's bones in Rogue Oliphant?
Well, you know, I'm fascinated by the business of writing songs or trying to write songs, which is as much as I would ever say about it. It's a fascinating activity. Of course, mostly I try to write poems, but songs are a slightly different animal. They're related, of course, but slightly different. So I'm fascinated by the process, and I have the great luxury of working with a fabulous band to try to make that happen.
It's probably too long an answer, but can you give me some sense of what is the big difference between writing a song and writing a poem? A poem is a lyric, after all, quite often.
Yeah, that's right. And the term lyric is used of many poems, usually short poems, and it suggests, of course, that in many cultures, the poem was set to music. It was accompanied by a lyre or some such instrument, a harp of some kind. The big difference, the elevator version of this, is the poem brings its own music. The song needs music to allow it to be what it most might be in the world. That's the short answer.
I'll take that and I'll run with that for the time being. Obviously, I mean, it's the placing of writing and music together that is at the heart of Muldoon's Picnic. Where did the idea originally come from? It started back in 2014, but I believe it's a much older art form that you kind of, that you want to, reimagine here.
Well, you know, I think it probably, some version of it started with the lyre and people sitting around a campfire. I mean, there have been marvelous versions of it in the 19th century. For example, when Muldoon's Picnic, the show after which this one is named, was very, very popular in New York. So popular, in fact, that there were two competing versions of it. But, you know, in our own, I love the variety show as a concept, Sunday Night at the London Palladium. And I often think of what used to happen on a Sunday morning when I was growing up on RTE, when you had Sunday Miscellany followed by Ciarán Mac Mahúna and Muchiol Hu. And so that the combination of music and words, prose, fiction, and poems is a tried and true. It's a tried and true recipe, and people love it, and we love it.
Yeah, and I mean, obviously, this is a more formal version of a performance in a theatre, in various theatres around the country, with some great writers and some great musicians who'll be with you in the various venues. We'll get some of the detail of that. But I have sitting here in front of me a little book called The Ulster Reciter, Ballads, Poems and Recitations for Every Occasion. I wondered how much Ulster reciting went on in the Muldoon household when the young Paul's ears were pricked up and listening.
Well, quite a lot. And is that edited by Joe McPartland?
It is. It is.
Yes. Well, Joe, I knew very well. Joe was a great actor from Northern Ireland, and I remember him putting that book together. Yeah, we were reared on many things. We were reared on, the English ballad tradition, of course, the Scottish ballad tradition, and the Irish ballad tradition, and also the worldwide tradition of recitation. You know, everything from the cremation of Sam McGee right through to our own great local hero, W.F. Marshall, the bard of Tyrone, who wrote such brilliant verses and brilliant poems. So that tradition, I think, is vital. And I consider all of that to be part of the poetic tradition.
Yeah.
It's all one thing.
You had the great joy recently of being involved with Paul McCartney in the book of his lyrics, and you brought him into your class. It was a surprise for those who were in your group. Did you bring him actually in to give them some hints around songwriting?
Well, I did. He was kind enough to come in by Zoom. I mean, the Zoom era for teachers like myself was problematical. There were many downsides, but there were upsides, one of them being the fact that we could bring Paul McCartney in via Zoom into a class I run called How to Write a Song. And so he came in, and in this class, there are maybe 30 students. They divide into groups of maybe four or five. And each week they write a song and they come in and sing it. And he critiqued the six or eight songs that we were listening to that week. And, it was quite a wonderful experience. One of the things that, you know, comes across from it, comes out of it, is the fact that, as he said along the way, had he not been a Beatle, he would probably have been a high school English teacher. So there's plenty of evidence that he would have been a very good one.
Does that mean, can I make the opposite a proposal, that had he not been a Pulitzer Prize winning poet and lecturer, he might have been a songwriter in the case of Paul Muldoon?
You know, I mean, I love music. I mean, I love it. And I love to be able to be around musicians. And we've got a fabulous array of musicians coming up on this tour of Muldoon's Picnic, Iarla O'Leonard, Zoe Conway and John McIntyre, a Duke Special, Lisa Lamb, Horselips, or members of Horselips. so we've got a great company of musicians coming out on the road with us, and I just love being with them.
Well, let's have a listen to you. You mentioned Lisa Lam there, and this brings Lisa Lam and Paul McCartney together, in fact, in the performance of Blackbird. And this was from a concert at the National Concert Hall. You were involved in this as well. Jack O'Rourke was there, and this RTE Concert Orchestra presenting the music of Paul McCartney. And in fact, it's going to be broadcast in full at this Bank Holiday Monday. The concert is on RTE Radio 1. Let's have a listen to a little bit of Blackbird in the version with Lisa Lam singing.
Blackbird singing in the dead of night, take these broken wings and learn to fly all your life. You were only waiting for this moment to rise. Blackbird singing in the dead of night, take these sunken eyes and learn to see all your life. Moment to be free. Blackbird, fly. Blackbird, fly into the light of the dark black night.
Just a little flavour there of Blackbird, a recording made actually in Studio One, in fact, with the RTE Concert Orchestra presenting the music of Paul McCartney. Paul Muldoon, guest singers Jack O'Rourke and Lisa Lam, all part of that. And as I say, it will be broadcast in full this Bank Holiday Monday at 2 p.m. But when I listen to that song, Paul, it's you know, we're used to it with the guitar, and I kind of thought to myself, how's it going to get bigger when the orchestra gets in behind it? But a great song does that, doesn't it? It can expand and contract as needs be.
I think that's right. I mean, it's like a great play, or indeed a great poem. Each time you come to it, or a great painting, any work of art, I think it's. I run the risk of sounding a bit fanciful here, but I think it's at some profound level. Each time you come back to it, you see something, you hear something, you find something that you hadn't quite heard before. And Lisa Lam's version of it is just wondrous. I mean, her phrasing is spectacular. And the orchestra is sounding fabulous.
No, it sounds absolutely gorgeous. I'm really looking forward to hearing the programme in full on Monday here on RT Radio 1. I'm wondering, too, about how you curate the readings and the writers alongside the music. Or is there a kind of free-fall feel to it? I mean, I know that you're going to have, for example, in Limerick, I think it's in the first performance, isn't it? Kevin Barry will be there, Vona Grork will be there, Lisa Lam will be there, and members of Horselips, all of those in Limerick together. So how fixed is the set before you start?
Well, what I do is try to nail, you know, I have a wish list. Some people are not able to take part in some cases. And then, you know, from venue to venue, I try to figure out who might be available for a particular venue. I'm trying to find a novelist, a short story writer, prose writer of some kind. So Kevin, I think I came in very early on, and Vona Grork. So we have a poet. So it's a mixed economy. Lisa then, and Horselips, who are of course, you know, one of the mainstays of the musical history of this country. And so that is just going to be, in a strange way, that's about the right number of guests. We usually hear from each of them a couple of times in each part of the show, and it allows them room to spread their wings, actually, and to have a bit of fun. And they often combine. I would be very surprised if Lisa Lam doesn't do something with Horselips.
Yeah, yeah.
And then we move on to Letterkenny on the Friday. We have Hannah Sullivan and Maurice Reardon, a Duke special, Claire Keegan, then to Belfast.
The guest list is it's a great guest list. Like Roddy Doyle is there too. It's an extraordinary. Earl Leonard with Nick Laird and Zadie Smith. But I wanted to ask you, did you nudge? Because it seems as if you got on incredibly well with Paul McCartney when you were working on the lyrics book with him. I saw an interview that a public interview that you did in the Albert Hall, and you were the best of buddies. It was clear. Did you nudge him in the direction of a Muldoon's picnic in Liverpool or somewhere like that?
Well, it has been done we've been in Edinburgh, and I think there have been hopes to go to London along the way. So you never know. But I might well ask. I mean, one of the things, of course, one learns in this business is if you don't ask, you'll never know.
That's for sure. That sounds like a very definite maybe to me. Let's finish up with a poem, a new poem, I believe this is, Paul, The Mourner. Will you introduce it for us?
I will, and thank you so much for allowing me to read it. It's a newish poem. It's for those of you with an interest in these matters. It's a sonnet, so you might hear a few little chimes going by there as you're listening to it. But it's... As with almost all of my poems, I try to switch things around. I try to do something unlikely. I try to do something unexpected. So let's see how we get on with this. The Mourner. It's from the point of view of the person in the grave. From deep within my grave, I must have been hoping to present less of a target to those who would make me an object of grief. The use of ergot to loosen the birth knot and generally bring on labour had also proved invaluable to hastening my end. That silent V in Lefebvre pointed to the space in which an archer might train his ash arrow on an ash tree. I was able to gauge this most recent arc from the green stain where a mourner had now gone down on one knee, the better to find his mark.
An unusual point of view for sure to get from the voice in a poem. Thanks very much for being with us this evening, Paul.
It's a pleasure. Thank you for having us.
That's Paul Muldoon, and that was his poem, The Mourner. Muldoon's Picnic is at the Lime Tree Theatre in Limerick on the 10th of August, on Greenown and Letterkenny on the 12th, the Lyric Theatre in Belfast on the 13th, Peacock Stage of the Abbey Theatre on the 14th. Lyric, you can find out all of the details, Lime Tree Theatre on greenown.com, lyric.co.uk and abbeytheatre.ie. And that, the RTE Concert Orchestra presents the music of Paul McCartney with Paul Muldoon, guest singer Jack O'Rourke, Lisa Lam, Alva Reddy on Bank Holiday Monday, 1st of August, 2 p.m. here on RTE Radio 1. For 5 years now, Rough Magic Theatre Company have provided the dramatic centrepiece at the Kilkenny Arts Festival. For the last two of those years, they brought their productions indoors with Solar Bones and Tonic, but now with COVID on the run, they're back outside and can complete their planned trio of productions of Shakespeare's plays. We've already had A Midsummer Night's Dream and Much Ado About Nothing, and now they're giving us what many consider to be Shakespeare's final play, The Tempest. The island full of noises, sounds and sweet airs where Prospero the magician and her cohort live will be imagined in the grounds of Kilkenny Castle. Prospero is exiled on this island because she was the subject of a coup instigated by her brother Antonio and the King of Milan, Alonso, back in her home city of Naples some 12 years previously. Now, as luck would have it, or rather as the magician Prospero has commanded it, her nemesis and brother Antonio and King Alonso have, because of the tempest of the play's titled, been shipwrecked on the island. So the stage is set for revenge. And yes, when I referred to Prospero, one of the great Shakespearean characters, I did say she and her, because in this Rough Magic production, the role of Prospero is played by Eleanor Methven. Delighted that Eleanor's with me in studio this evening, along with director Lynn Parker. As I said to you when you came in through the door, Eleanor, this is a great idea. And I'm sure when Lynn said it to you, you thought, this is an absolutely brilliant idea.
Yeah.
Has it stayed that way?
It has. No, it absolutely has. This is one of the great roles. But it's, and as you were saying there, you know, Shakespeare's later, we think, last play. The poetry is just so powerful. And it is also about the theatre, about a life in the theatre, and the chance to get hold of it and play it is a gift. It's wonderful.
And was it a role that, you know, at any point along in your career you thought, oh, I'd like to get to Prospero eventually? Would you have thought of that?
Not at all. I mean, really only in the last, well, should we say maybe 20 years have women started to take on these traditionally male Shakespeare roles. So no, back in the day, not at all. It would never have occurred to me that I'd ever play Prospero, Lear, any of them at all. No, it was Lynn that came to me and said, I'm doing Midsummer Night's Dream. And I thought, well, sorry, not Midsummer Night's Dream. What play are we in? The Tempest. It's been a long day. Yeah, it was Lynn's idea completely. And I just thought, how wonderful. And yeah, what a gift.
And Lynn, for you, I mean, that the gender fluidity within casting has certainly become something in more recent times. But did you, when you start thinking of the play with those gender switches, does it become a totally different piece?
To an extent. I mean, I've been gender so shifting from a very early point in my career. I famously cast Anne Enright as Everyman when we were at college. So it seemed to me that when the role was right and the actor was right, then why not? And I don't think you can do it with every role, but with Prospero, I think there is absolutely no reason not to. And it makes for very interesting new takes on the relationships within the play, particularly with Miranda, her daughter.
Yeah, so in the case of the play, when Prospero is played by a male, it's his daughter on the island, and there's all sorts of talks around the type of control he has over mother-daughter relationships are very different things.
Well, there's still a lot of implicit control, as any mother-daughter will admit, but it's of a very different order, and we removed a lot of the references to chastity, which just seemed to us to be completely unhelpful. But there's still a very powerful relationship, and what's brilliant is that you and one of the reasons I wanted Eleanor to play this part was that, you know, there's an enormously complex person at the heart of it, but a very strong personality, and you see that reflected in her daughter, who has really been brought up without any of the guile and sort of shapes that women in society have to adopt. She's lived on an island and she's been her own woman from the very start. So actually there's a very interesting dynamic there.
And Eleanor, you know, any actor reading a play, if you're reading a play and, you know, like if you're a young actor, for example, at the age in your 20s, you're not really going to be thinking of Prospero as the part you might get in it. So you read the play in a different way. And I'm sure you had read The Tempest, you know, in and of its own, without thinking of yourself as Prospero. Yeah. When you shifted into reading it, knowing that you were playing Prospero, what switched in the play?
I actually did. I was in a production of The Tempest when, you know, God was young back in the Lyric, and I played the goddess Iris and various shapeshifters and so on. The interesting thing is, of course, you're reading it with a female gaze and thinking, how does this affect your relationship with Miranda? It also affects, I think, her relationship with Ferdinand, this young fella that comes along. So it's those kind of things, really. It's just that female gaze coming onto it and how you feel about life. But she's still of royal birth, and we have to accept that thing that she believes it is her divine right to rule. There's all that stuff. But this time it's her younger brother who supplanted her. Whereas, of course, if it's a man playing it, then it is that eldest son thing. It automatically goes through. That's not the case here. But it's a human being, regardless, looking back on their time on this earth, as Shakespeare was at that time, and looking back at what they've done, which is this theatre art, and talking about how you let it go and how you pass things on, not only to your daughter, but in your profession.
Well, I think that might feed into the section that you're going to read for us. So let's hear a bit of Prospero. Then, what's the context here? We're towards the end of the play.
Yeah, towards the end, when she's just about to bring everybody together and, it, you know, introduce them to them, literally to themselves and to each other. And it is her deciding that this is the time when she lets go all the magic she's had on this island. Ye elves of hills, brooks, standing lakes and groves, and ye that on the sands with printless foot do chase the ebbing Neptune and do fly him when he comes back. You demi-puppets, that by moonshine do the green-sour ringlets make, whereof the ewe not bites. And you, whose pastime is to make midnight mushrooms that rejoice to hear the solemn curfew, by whose aid, weak masters though ye be, I have bedimmed the noontide sun, called forth the mutinous winds, and twixt the green sea and the azured vault set roaring war. To the dread rattling thunder have I given fire, and rifted Jove's stout oak with his own bolt. The strong-based promontory have I made shake, and by the spurs plucked up the pine and cedar. Graves at my command have waked their sleepers, oped and let them forth by my so potent art. But this rough magic I here abjure. And when I have required some heavenly music, which even now I do, to work mine end upon their senses that this airy charm is for, I'll break my staff, bury it certain fathoms in the earth, and deeper than did ever plummet sound, I'll drown my book.
That's Eleanor Methven as Prospero, giving us a lovely radio performance of that, I have to say, because you're on the microphone right now. It is an outdoor performance that we'll be getting in Kilkenny. But I have to say that just the sheer poetry of that, and of course, this rough magic I hear of your
is
you probably why you chose that piece. It's where the company got its name.
That's right. Yeah. And we actually did a production of it in 1987 or something like that. But just to talk about the delivery of the poetry, we are actually amplifying and miking the actors.
Right.
Because this is such a poetic piece, such a musical piece, that it would be impossible to play, particularly with Irish summers, if you were sort of like hollering against a wind. And so it's very important that the sound design, the Isle is indeed full of noises, and Dennis Clossy's noises a lot. He's the composer and sound designer who is melding the actors' dialogue with this extraordinary atmospheric sound design and music.
And the shift of location to the grounds of Kilkenny Castle itself, that will give you it's almost like a bigger forum, really, a bigger kind of feel of it, is it?
Yeah, it's funny. I always thought I would do the Tempest in a big old-fashioned theatre with all the paraphernalia and machinery. And we're in a field. We're in Kilkenny Castle Park, miles away from the actual castle. Well, yards away. And we will be playing against a backdrop of the cosmos, really. It's the sky. It's the trees. It's nature. So we were very interested in the idea of nature and natural magic being a core element. So that's where the idea of radio waves and electricity come from, which, you know, is of course what lightning is made of, and Jove's thunder. And it was kind of interesting to work that into the design as well.
Yeah, I think you've said it in a kind of an 18th, 19th century period where we're kind of at the cusp of where science is kind of becoming science, as opposed to people thinking that's magic that those people are doing. And it was often women scientists who were not mentioned. So it's interesting that you give that role to Prospero.
Yeah.
But in that speech that we just heard as well, Eleanor, you know, she has put certain, she's putting things to bed, she's putting them down. Mm-hmm. But this is a woman, she gets her nemesis, she gets her brother onto this island.
Yeah.
She's hell-bent on revenge. How big a theme is revenge within the play and within the character of Prospero?
Yeah. Well, certainly she has been done wrong by her brother, and she does cause the tempest that brings him to this island. The whole journey of the play, I think, for Prospero is, now my enemies are at my mercy, what do I do? That's the question. So it is a play about having the opportunity. Wouldn't we all love it to take revenge on our enemies, whatever? But what do you do with that? Do you show mercy? Is there redemption? So it's a journey of self-discovery and redemption and restoring things.
Of course, there are other characters, fascinating characters within the play as well, not least which is Ariel and Caliban, which I think was perhaps a part that you wanted to play previously. Eleanor, is this true?
That is true. Many years ago in London, we were discussing it, and I said to Lynch, I'll shave my head someday and play Caliban, you know, but no, John Cronin is going to be far better than I could ever be.
All right. Well, best of luck with the production. It will be at the Kilkenny Arts Festival from August the 3rd through until the 6th, and then the 8th through until the 13th. Full details on kilkennyartsfestival.ie.
Under the Banner of Heaven, the new series from Disney Plus is inspired by the true crime bestseller by John Krakauer. It follows the events that led to the 1984 murder of Brenda Wright Lafferty, played here by Daisy Edgar-Jones, and also Brenda Wright Lafferty's baby daughter. And this murder took place in the suburb in Salt Lake Valley in Utah. The detective, Jeb Pyrie, played by Andrew Garfield, investigates events which transpired within the Lafferty family. He uncovers buried truths about the origins of the Latter-day Saints religion and the violent consequences of unyielding faith. What Pyrie, a devout Mormon, unearths leads him to question his own faith. Declan Burke has been watching Under the Banner of Heaven for us, and he's with me in studio this evening. The book here, John Krakauer, a true crime and not a book of non-fiction, therefore. It's quite a dark piece.
Very much so, Sean. And the subtitle of it, A Story of Violent Faith, which I think is a great opener into what this series is all about. Published in 2003, it's strange that it's taken this long to get to the screen, but very dark. I mean, it's we've all seen TV series about serial killers and the classic murder mystery stories and so forth. This is one is obviously steeped in religious values that, you know, even at the early stages, and we don't want to give away too much about it because it's a murder mystery, but obviously these are religious values that are perverted, I suppose, when they're taken to their extreme, which is, you can say that about any religion. This is specifically the Mormon community, the Church of the Latter-day Saints, in this particular series.
Yeah, and the place that we're in is East Rockwall, kind of a typical small town America, really, isn't it? But a small town America where 99.99% of the population are Mormons, and therefore they are not used to crime or to anything of a dark nature, we think, at all.
Well, that's the impression we're given at the start. It's an idyllic scenario presented in over the credits. It's that kind of cookie cutter town, small American town that we're used to. In fact, the opening credits, Let's Hear for the Boy, is kind of played over, which is from the original soundtrack of Footloose, which also was a small town with a very deeply conservative ethic. Now, as the credits end, we see Jeb Pyrie, the detective, we see his children playing on the front lawn, and they're very normal children, except they're wearing these kind of weird Victorian-era dresses. You're thinking, that's a bit strange. And it gives us a sense of how conservative this community is.
And also, when he gets a phone call from the station to say that there's a problem, and you know from what he's saying that this is a pretty big problem, he doesn't go straight to the station.
No, he doesn't. He assembles the family immediately for the evening prayer, because this is obviously, you know, a priority for the family. He's a very distinctive, very unusual detective, as the listeners can tell from what we're talking about. And also, very refreshingly, he doesn't seem to have a problem with authority, Sean. He's not a heavy abuser of alcohol and so forth. Very normal, clean-cut, upstanding member of the community, which is informed by his Mormon faith. But we know very early in the story that's going to be severely tested as the story unfolds.
Yeah, because as is often the case in fiction and indeed in real life, if a wife is murdered, the first suspect is going to be the husband, and pretty quickly the husband is brought in for questioning.
Well, he is, and there's a very good reason in this, because when Pyrie attends the murder scene, and it's very effectively done, it's a horrific scene which we don't get to see. We only get to see it through his eyes and his reaction. And when we see him kind of emotionally crumble and start to cry, we kind of think, well, thank God they're not showing us that scene.
And yeah, when he walks outside, there's a policeman standing there, and he said, will you go back in? He said, I'd rather not. And you really get a sense that even the policemen have no experience of this type of event.
Absolutely, yeah. It's a tough scene, but also, as you say, this is a town in which they don't have an awful lot of violence. But as he exits the house, a man is coming across the street, spattered in blood, and we quickly realise this is the husband. So it's no surprise, really, that he is immediately arrested and taken to the station.
Yeah, he's taken in. And Pyrie is the kind of the good cop in this sequence, and Bill Tabber, playing Gil Birmingham, is kind of the bad cop, he's the kind of tough questioner here, isn't he? Initially, at any rate.
Yeah, he's the pragmatic one, and he's not Mormon. That's very important. So he's kind of got an outsider's view on this Mormon community, and he's not willing to buy into the cliches.
All right, let's listen to a clip then. Jeb Pyrie, played by Andrew Garfield, Bill Tabber, played by Gil Birmingham, and they're questioning Brenda's husband, Alan, played by Bill Howley. This is after the body and her body and the body of her daughter have been discovered.
please, please find the rest of my family. My brothers and their wives and kids.
Why would I have to find them all?
If there's someone out there hunting my family, then, you know, they could be in trouble.
Give us addresses. We'll do safety checks right now.
I don't know their addresses.
You don't know where your own brothers live?
No, they moved. Sam moved. Robin moved. I'm not lying to you, sir. Please.
And who'd want to hunt them down?
Well, for the past year or more, men, peculiar men, were taken with my family. They had beards, long beards.
Like vagrants?
You know how often the old vagrants killed my wife? Story pans out, Alan.
Not vagrants, like Bible or Book of Mormon prophets. Please help me find the rest of my family.
And that's Bill Howell there as the character of Alan, the husband of the woman who has been murdered, and the young girl, the father of the young girl who's been murdered. Jeb Pyrie, played by Andrew Garfield, and Gil Birmingham playing the character of Bill Taiba there in the scene from Under the Banner of Heaven, a true crime non-fiction series that we're getting on Disney. Really, Alan himself, the young man who's been questioned, is a member of the Lafferty family. The Lafferty family. I don't know how you begin to describe them. There's so many of them, for starters, is the problem. But it's quite a unusual unit, this family, yeah, isn't it?
Yes, it is. And a clan probably is what you're getting at there, Sean, rather than a family. It's a really extended...
Yeah.
They're described at one point as the Utah Kennedys, which brought a smile to my face. They're not a political family in the kind of literal sense, but they're very quote-unquote highly regarded within their community. And to be fair to them, the patriarch, Ammon, he's a very devout Mormon, and when anybody needs help, he's the first to volunteer to go and help them. But in an extended flashback, we see when Brenda Lafferty, played by Daisy Edgar-Jones, when she's first introduced to the family at this kind of picnic, and she's kind of swarmed by all these people, and it's, you know, it's kind of funny to start with, but there's a real sense, and it's brilliantly filmed, there's a real sense of nervous energy, of forced jollity, and you kind of, I certainly got the sense there's almost a cultish quality to this
kind
family.
Of sexual undertones that are... that you'd be uncomfortable if you were in the company, you'd be uncomfortable with the kind of sideways glances and innocuous remarks that in fact are barbed as well as being innocuous.
Yeah, and I don't know if we mentioned Brenda Lafferty is Mormon. She's from Idaho, which is not the same, we learn, as being a Utah Mormon. But so she just assumes that this is all kind of friendly and there's no... But as an outsider, as a non-Mormon, if I can put it that way, watching this, as you say, there's something slightly not right about the comments, particularly from Alan's brothers, his older brothers.
Yeah, we'll have a clip that gives a sense of that. The Idaho is referred to as the potato head. That she's a potato head because she's from Idaho. We listen to a clip here. Daisy Edgar-Jones, as you say, playing the character of Brenda. She's introduced to Alan, Bill Howley again. His brother Ron, played by Sam Worthington, and Ron's wife, Diana, who's played by Denise Scoff. Huge Lafferty family gathering, and you get a sense of the atmosphere in this clip, I think.
I'm not going into soil science like my very smart father.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm going into television. Wow.
By the way you look, you must be an actress.
Oh, gosh, no. Mm-hmm. No, I read the news.
How exciting.
Well, I'd like to one day. Until I start a family, of course, and, you know, I'll take a little break. Nothing wrong with having it all now, is there?
Don't listen to him. He's just teasing. He's just in construction.
No, he started the best construction company in Utah.
Of course, I'm sorry.
I actually saw your new place on the way here.
What'd you think?
Yeah, it's great, isn't it?
Oh, yeah.
Ron sits on the city council. He's first counselor in his bishopric, and...
Keep going, you make it sound impressive.
Brenda's potato head dad is a bishop.
Is that right?
Oh, yeah. Well, he's not on any city council and doesn't build fourplexes, so how do you make time for it all in family?
Oh, there's plenty of time later. You know, eternity lasts forever.
Oh, my gosh. You sound just like my dad.
I'm going to be back in a minute.
All right. Okay,
sorry.
He's cute, isn't he? I have the oldest. You grab the youngest, and then we can compare notes.
even that's slightly uncomfortable, isn't it? The wife, Denise Goff, Diana, referring to the husband as he walks off, he's cute, isn't he? And obviously has picked up on the chemistry between the Brenda character played by Daisy Edgar-Jones and the Ron character played by Sam Worthington. It's an unusual family. We should explain that obviously what we get is the murder has happened. Then we get not just one set of flashbacks, but a kind of an earlier flashback as well. Explain the first set of flashbacks, which is to this period in time when the Daisy Edgar-Jones character is brought into the Lafferty family.
Well, as we were talking about, that's to establish A, what the Lafferty family are like, and B, why the Brenda character is slightly out of sync with, because they're Utah Mormons, the Idaho Mormons are regarded as more libertarian, if I can use that phrase, about the Mormon faith. But so she is finding them to be slightly clannish, to be slightly cultish, to be not quite. But, you know, she loves her boyfriend, so she's prepared to play along with the kind of sinister undertones.
But there are definitely looks between her and some of the brothers, and her, in fact, even and the father of the family, that are uncomfortable to watch.
Yeah, and particularly the father, this Ammon, this character, this patriarchal character who, you know, he rules with an iron fist and so forth, and he dispenses his favours and justice. And, you know, I suppose as viewers we're being led to believe, you know, is Eamon responsible for what happens? Because we learn very early, Sean, that there's apostasy is why Alan is alleging his wife and daughter have been murdered. It's because he has left the Mormon faith and revenge has been taken by quote-unquote hairy Mormon prophets.
Yeah, and then there's a further flashback to the founder of the Mormon church.
Yeah, and that's where I think the series is going to be particularly interesting, because it's Joseph Smith that we were shown the kind of formative years of the Mormon church and why Joseph Smith was inspired to form a church, but also digs into slightly dark, very dark moments in the origins of Mormon history that's completely new to me, but suggests that there is going to be quite a lot of, as I said, that dark history going to be pulled out to be examined.
There is always the question with a true crime story, particularly whatever about it on the page, when you see it up on screen and you see beautiful actors and beautiful actresses playing those roles, making entertainment out of that. I know we've only seen one episode so far. Is that line being crossed or being tread very carefully?
When I was watching it, I was wondering, I'd be curious to know what a Mormon reviewer would have made of this show. I would also slightly clarify the word entertainment. I don't think it's just there to entertain and titillate. I think this is as much about an informative piece of work. I think it's a serious piece of work that's going to be as much about the history of the Mormon religion as it is about this particular crime.
You're going to watch the rest of
this. I am already hooked. I'm really looking forward to it.
Episode one was really interesting. Declan Burke speaking to us about Under the Banner of Heaven, which will be on Disney Plus under the Star banner in Ireland from the 27th of July. The 1973 film Pat Garrett and Billy the Kid has an extraordinary pedigree of cast and crew. Actors James Coburn, Chris Christopherson and Jason Roberts, all guided by the creative eye of the legendary film director Sam Peckinpah. On top of that, the film boasts an acting part and a film score from Bob Dylan, which included the track Knocking on Heaven's Door, telling the story of an ageing Pat Garrett and his attempts to bring down his old friend Billy the Kid. The film had a troubled history, with director Peckinpah ousted and many cast and crew disowning the film on its original release. However, in later years, when Peckinpah revisited the movie, it was re-evaluated by critics, with many hailing it as a forgotten classic. This Thursday, July the 28th, the Irish Film Institute in Dublin will host a special screening of Pat Garrett and Billy the Kid, with an introduction by Hot Press journalist Pat Carthy, who's with me in studio this evening. Just give us the essence of what's going on here in terms of the Pat Garrett character and why he's trying to get Billy the Kid. He's a changed man, Pat Garrett, from the Billy the Kid. They were pals along
the
way.
That's right. They ran together. They both worked on Chisholm's Ranch. This is in the real world now. It isn't really mentioned in the movie. But he's an older man now. And as the movie starts off, he has decided to take a job as sheriff. And he comes to see Billy the Kid one last time to warn him. Say, look, he suggests in the first couple of scenes, listen, maybe you should head down to Mexico. Mexico's nice this time of year. Why don't you go down there? And he says, look, I'm asking you now.
Yeah.
But I'll be making you do it in 5 days' time.
Yeah, well, let's listen to the warning, because it brings up, I think, one of the central themes of this, which is kind of the big corporations. Mm-hmm. And you've got to remember the time that it was made, even though it's harking back to the Western format. This is Pat Garrett and Billy the Kid, James Coburn and Chris Christopherson.
I didn't figure you'd bother to make a ride out here.
Shit, you know me better than that. We did have some ties, didn't we? It's gotta be pretty hard to turn your back on all that, ain't it?
The electorate. Once you've gone out of the country.
But are they telling me? Are they asking me?
I'm asking you. But in 5 days, I'm making you.
Sheriff Fat Garrett. Sold out to the Santa Fe Rain.
How does it feel?
It, feels like times have changed.
Times, maybe. Not me.
So that's Pat Garrett, played by James Coburn, Billy the Kid, played by Chris Christopherson, in a scene from Pat Garrett and Billy the Kid. Pat Carty with me in studio this evening talking about it. I mentioned that it was kind of, what happened to the film when it came out, first of all? It was this Western. It's a very slow-moving film. It was very long.
It is. But there's three different versions of it. I mean, there was all sorts of problems with the making of it. And there was problems with MGM, who were behind it at the time. And MGM had just built the MGM Grand in Las Vegas. So it was all about the bottom line to end. They were trying to get films out before Labor Day. So they gave this they wouldn't supply the budget that Peckinpah was after. There was problems with the camera. There was bad footage shot. They had to do stuff on the run. And by the time the film came back to MGM, they gave an unrealistic time frame for the Peckinpah to edit it. And then eventually they took it off and brought in other editors. So the version that's released in 1973 is the shortest of the three versions. And it's very rarely seen now. And it was disowned by everybody involved in it. It was a box office failure. People didn't really get it. A lot of the exposition was taken out of it. But there was a director's cut, what was called a director's cut at the time, which was in the Directors Guild of America contracts, all directors have within 10 weeks of filming to hand in this cut of it. And that cut survived. And that's the one that came out in 1988. So that would have been when I saw it, now in 1988. And then, again in 2005, a group of experts, Peckinpah experts, got together and kind of made the best of both worlds. So this special edition is the one that's been shown this Thursday.
Right.
Slightly shorter than the Peckinpah one. And I think it's tighter. It's a better film.
All right. But the style of film that we get, we got a sense of it in that clip. You know, the dialogue is very slow. There's lots of eyeballing each other. There's the touch of the spaghetti western about it, for sure. Not musically.
No.
But you have that kind of big, vast, empty spaces, big, vast landscapes, and then these men within it eyeballing each other, and then boom, a gun.
Yeah,
it takes its time
getting to where it's going. It falls into that genre called revisionist western. So it's not as clean cut, should I say, as when my father used to go to the cinema and watch Hopalong Cassidy. You know, it's not that kind of a western.
Yeah,
there's no. I make a point in that article I wrote about it that there's no white hats in it. Those westerns in the old days, you had a white hat, you could tell who was the good guy, and a black hat, you could tell who was the bad guy. But they're all wearing black hats in this, or grey hats. It's grey. It's there's no real good guy as such in this.
Yeah, but does that speak to the time when it was first made in 1973?
Well, I think that's part of it, certainly.
We heard in that clip, the clip that we listened to as well, this idea that, you know, there's a group of businessmen around
that's
here.
That's right, yeah.
And they want you out of here.
The Santa Fe Ring, as they were called, which was a real thing around, which involved these group of lawyers and land speculators who did a lot of corrupt deals at the time. And Peckinpah was kind of trying to say, look, this was the change, the old individual West. The West built on the individual was fading away. And I suppose that tied in at the time. So you're talking about the time Watergate, you're talking about the revelations of Vietnam coming out, big business lying to people, you know. And but I think watching it in our era, you can say, well, Packard kind of represents us. You kind of, as you get older, there's a line in where he says, look, the country's getting older and I mean to get old with it. And we all kind of have to do that a bit when we're old. You might want to be Billy, but we're really Pat. You know what I mean?
All right. And also within this is one Bob Dylan, responsible for the musical score, which means that we get a kind of a guitar score for the most part.
Yeah.
But there's also a little bit of acting done. Let's have a listen to. Only a little. I'm going to give you about 30 seconds of him. Bob Dylan as Alias.
That's your name, boy.
Alias.
Alias what?
Alias anything you please.
What do we call you?
Alias. Hell, just call him Alias. That's what I'd do.
You know, he doesn't have a lot to say. He doesn't have a lot.
Thankfully,
he doesn't have a lot to do. But what? Why on earth did Sam Peckinpah bring Dylan into this? I mean, he had Coburn and he had Christopherson and other actors, Jason Roberts.
He was brought in. Dylan was a friend of the screenwriter, a fellow called Rudy Wurlitzer, and Wurlitzer approached him to write a song about it. And then he brought the song to Sam, and Sam didn't know who Bob Dylan was. He thought he was Roger Miller, that King of the Road guy, and he said that to James Coburn, and James Coburn said, "No, Bob Dylan." So they brought him down to Mexico. He gave him this part. The part originally in the screenplay was a bit more complicated, but Dylan didn't really have the chops to carry it off. You know, it's a lovely soundtrack, but he's not the world's greatest actor.
You talked about some of the problems on set. How difficult was Sam Peckinpah? I mean, what had he achieved up to this?
Well, you're talking about he'd made movies like The Wild Bunch, which is a very famous movie from 1969, and a great movie from before that called Ride the High Country. So he'd had his ups and downs. He'd made Major Dundee with Charlton Heston. That was a disaster. But he was an alcoholic at this stage. James Coburn said, look, he was a genius about 4 hours of the day. That was when you got him. And then the rest of the time, he wasn't much use. So that was part of the problem.
Yeah.
You know, he didn't make it easy for himself, put it that way. But, you know, art won out in the end. And this film is a piece of genius. I really think it is.
I have to say that the music sits kind of oddly with the style of the filmmaking.
Perhaps,
and I'm going to finish up with a little bit of Bob Dylan and Knocking on Heaven's Door.
Hmm.
Now, while this...
Scene is the greatest.
While the film may not have launched his acting career, Knocking on Heaven's Door was hugely important for his musical career.
It was a hit single. He hadn't had one in a couple of years. And it's the most famous scene from the movie. It's the famous
What's happening as we hear...
Slim Pickens has been shot.
Slim Pickens.
Yeah, Slim Pickens.
Great name,
And he's been shot. And he's making his way towards the river. And his wife is there. And his wife sees that he's been shot. And they both look at each other and know this is the end. Mm. And he's kind of just looking off at the river. And in the background, Coburn is looking on with a look on his face and said, "I caused this. I'm really killing myself here." That's what the movie's about, I think.
Take this badge off of me. I can't use it anymore. It's getting dark, too dark to see. I feel I'm knocking on heaven's door. Knock, knock, 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 knocking on heaven's door.
Yes, the Bob Dylan song that is the heart of the film. Pat Garrett and Billy the Kid. Pat Carty telling us about that Sam Peckinpah movie. This Thursday, July the 20th, there will be a screening of the 2005 cut of the film at the Irish Film Institute in Temple Bar, Dublin 2. The aforementioned Pat Carty will introduce the film before the screening. And this is part of the Irish Film Institute's bigger picture series of screenings, ifi.ie, for full details. And that is our lot for this evening. Liam Murphy and Paula Shields research. Michelle Gibson was the broadcast coordinator. Mark Dwyer was in sound this evening, and tonight's programme produced by Kay Sheehy. Talk to you tomorrow night, 7 o'clock, once again here on RT Radio 1. John Creedon will be with you after the news.